This is Redgate Woods, which makes up just a small part of the almost 70,000 acres of the Forest Preserve of Cook County. Buried below me are the remains of two very important nuclear reactors, one of which was the world's first successful nuclear reactor. How it ended up being buried here is a peculiar story, especially considering it was built over 15 miles away in the city of Chicago. Why? Well, that's because of a letter from Albert Einstein.
August 2nd, 1939, Albert Einstein sent a letter to President Franklin D. Roosevelt informing him of the work done by two scientists, Enrico Fermi and Leo Szilard, which showed that uranium could be turned into a new and important source of energy, which could also lead to the creation of a new type of devastating bomb. He noted that Germany knew this too, and had already started stockpiling uranium. This set in motion a series of events that would lead to the creation of the Manhattan Project, a top-secret and multinational effort to beat the Nazis to the creation of an atomic bomb.
At the University of Chicago in 1942, the Metallurgical Laboratory, or MetLab, opened. It was just one of the many secret Manhattan Project sites operating across the country. There, Enrico Fermi continued his work on experimental piles and creating a nuclear chain reaction. The Met Lab expanded rapidly at the university, eventually consuming over 200,000 square feet of space. The university wasn't an ideal location to build a full-size pile, or reactor as they're called today. The army leased 1,088 acres here at the Argonne Forest to build a secure facility for the Met Lab's operations. Construction was planned to start immediately, but due to a union dispute and a lack of readily available skilled workers, the contractors failed to meet the October deadline.
Time was of the essence, and without a dedicated site to build a full-size reactor, Fermi decided to build it on a squash court under the west stands of the university's football field, Stagg Field. Over 40,000 graphite blocks were used to build Chicago Pile 1, 19,000 of which had holes bored into them to hold the uranium. Working around the clock, it took a team of scientists, laborers, and some 30 or so high school students who were recruited from back at the yards, almost 50 days to complete the reactor. On December 2nd, 1942, Fermi and 41 others gathered at the reactor to see if their experimental pile would work. From the balcony above, Fermi gave the orders to remove the zip and all but one control rod. Those long rods were coated in cadmium, which hindered a reaction from taking place. The last control rod was slowly removed as Fermi and his team monitored the reactions taking place inside the reactor. The needle climbed but soon leveled off as the reaction failed to self-sustain. Inching the control rod out further after each attempt yielded more favorable results for a chain reaction. On the verge of success, Fermi halted the experiment and ordered the team to lunch. They returned to work, and at 3 p.m. the control rod was pulled out one more foot, which delivered the desired result. The reactor gained momentum, generating heat and throwing off radiation without showing any signs of stopping. It was the first self-sustaining controlled nuclear reaction. The atomic age had begun. Under the stands of a football field on the south side of Chicago. Those who were present celebrated with a bottle of shandy.
The reactor ran for 4 minutes at only half a watt, enough to power a couple of LED Christmas lights. 10 days later, they increased the power to 200 watts, which is more than enough to cover your house in lights. In February of 1943, Chicago Pile 1 was disassembled and transferred here to the completed laboratory. It was reconfigured as Chicago Pile 2. Chicago Pile 3, the first heavy water reactor, was also constructed here and reached criticality on May 15, 1944.
The Argonne Laboratory became a central location for atomic reactor research and development. The work provided vital information and guidance to the larger reactors, which were focused on the mass production of fuel for an atomic bomb. After their success in Chicago, many of the scientists were called away to work on other parts of the Manhattan Project. Enrico Fermi would become the associate director of the Los Alamos Laboratory, where the atomic bomb was being constructed. He, along with others from Chicago, witnessed the Trinity bomb explosion. Leona Woods and others went to work at the larger reactors in Hanford and Oak Ridge, while Walter Zim and Leo Szilard continued work at the Argonne Laboratory. Remarkably, physicist Harold Anew saw the completion of the atomic bomb from start to finish. He was present when Chicago Pile 1 achieved the first controlled nuclear reaction and was the scientific observer to the bombing of Hiroshima, capturing the explosion on camera.
After the war, the Argonne National Laboratory continued its research into nuclear reactors. they outgrew this site, which was only meant to be temporary, and established a new location into Page County, where they still operate today. By 1954, the reactors and facilities here were obsolete. To return the land back to the Forest Preserve in the condition it was received, they dug a big hole and buried everything in it.
The radioactive material was removed from the reactors, and a ditch, 100 feet wide and 50 feet deep, was dug between them. Concrete was poured into Chicago Pile 3 to seal it up. This also brought its total weight to around 800 tons. Unable to be moved, they dug the ditch around it and exploded the pedestal of dirt supporting it. Chicago Pile 2, along with the remaining buildings, were leveled and pushed into the ditch. Another ditch, Plot M, was dug on the other side of the compound. There, the radioactive waste was buried and capped with concrete to prevent anyone from digging it up.
What was once Argonne Forest is now Redgate Woods, and it's completely accessible to the public, quite possibly making it the only nuclear disposal site that is. This site poses no risk to visitors, but due to public concern, a few cleanups did take place and several monitoring wells were installed. The area is monitored by the Department of Energy, who concluded that your odds of getting radiation exposure from visiting this site is the same as being killed by lightning.
The only remnants of what happened here are marked by two large rocks, which not only serve as monuments to the history, but as tombstones to what lies beneath the ground. Back at the University of Chicago, Stagg Field was demolished in 1957. This sculpture, Nuclear Energy by Henry Moore, and the adjacent library marked the original location where the first nuclear reactor was built. Although Chicago Pile 1 wasn't the last reactor to be unconventionally built at the university, since 1987, the students have held an annual scavenger hunt, and in 1999, 500 points were offered for a breeder reactor built in a shed. A laughable, if not impossible, task to say the least. Well, two physics students, Gillian Casper and Fred Neal, successfully constructed a plutonium-producing reactor from parts they gathered at the physics lab.
Thanks to Vincent for suggesting this story. If you would like to suggest your own, you can hit me up in the comments or on social media. Don't forget to like and subscribe and share this video with your Chicago friends.